Hi, my name is Stefan Wernley, and I work for the Azure Quantum team at Microsoft. I'm going to show you how I use Q-sharp, our quantum programming language, to help me explore quantum error correcting codes. So to get started, I've already got VS Code with the Azure Quantum Development Kit extension installed. As you can see, I've got an operation called encode, where I've copied the gate sequence from a paper that shows an efficient way to take a single physical qubit and encode its state into a register of 5 physical qubits to represent 1 logical error-corrected qubit. Inside of my main, I'm going to allocate 5 qubits, then call this encode operation, and reset all of my qubits before they go out of scope. I can double-check using our circuit visualization feature that the sequence of gates matches what I saw inside of the paper. Since it does, I know I'm ready to keep going. As part of the 5-qubit error-correcting code, also known as the perfect code, you need a set of generators that you'll use to do joint measurements to figure out if there are any single qubit errors in your register. I have the list of generators that I'm going to use pasted down below, so I'll copy those into a new operation that I'm going to call measure syndrome. That will take my register of qubits and return an integer that represents the syndrome measurement. Because Q-sharp has a built-in type for polys, I can use this array of polys and treat that as the argument to the measure operation that takes a list of polys and a list of qubits and then performs the joint measurement to figure out the parity using those poly operators. I call measure, I pass in the first of the generators and my qubit array, and then I do the same thing for each of the following generators. This allows me to very quickly and easily figure out what the syndrome of the error is that I'd like to characterize inside of this code. To turn it into an integer, I can use the result array as int utility from the Q-sharp standard library. Now back in my main, I can call the operation I just created to get back that integer and figure out what the syndrome measurement is when no errors have occurred. Because I'm simulating noiselessly, I expect this syndrome measurement to indicate no errors. For the set of generators that I've chosen, the 2 middle poly arrays are traditionally represented with a minus sign. That matches what I'd expect to see here, where I've gotten back the results 0, 1, 1, 0 to indicate that no error has occurred. I could invert the measurements, but instead I'm going to use this as an index for a table lookup in my next step. Once I know I have a reliable way of measuring the syndromes for my error-correcting code, I can generate the table that I need in order to know what error has occurred by intentionally injecting errors and seeing how that changes my syndrome measurements. Back in my main, I'll use 2 for loops, one that loops over each of the indices of the qubits in my register, and another that loops over each of the poly errors that I'd like to inject, poly X, poly Y, and poly Z. Inside, I'll use that register of 5 qubits, encode them, and then inject a specific poly error based on where I am in my iteration. Then I can get the syndrome for that particular poly error by calling the measure syndrome that I've already created. As you can see, each of the different errors produces a unique syndrome measurement. This is the key. I can use that unique syndrome measurement as an index in a lookup table that will tell me what error I need to correct. Let's generate that table. Back in my main, I can create a mutable table and then insert into that table at the index determined by the syndrome measurement what error it was that I injected. Now I've got a table that shows me what correction I need to apply for each syndrome measurement and allows me to correlate those syndrome measurements to the poly errors that generated them. I can copy that table and create a new function that knows how to actually correct the errors that could occur in my program. I'll copy the output, save my table generation code for later, and make a new function called correctError. Inside of correctError, I'll perform my syndrome measurement, and then use that to look up in the table I've created what correction needs to be applied to the qubit. To help me out with investigating the behavior of my code, I'll add an extra print here to show me which error is being corrected on which qubit. Now that I've got an operation that can correct arbitrary single qubit errors, let's test it out. I'll use the qubits that I had before and while they're encoded, I'll use the Q-sharp standard library to produce some random errors by randomly picking a poly and a rotation angle and updating one of the qubits using that rotation. Now that I've got my test code written, I'm injecting random errors on one qubit on each execution, and then calling my correct error function to see whether or not my syndrome measurements combined with my lookup table are able to detect and correct that error. As you can see, each execution will show whether an error was detected, like this poly Z error on the qubit at index 4, or if the syndrome measurements collapsed to a state with no error, like here where it shows poly I on index 0. On every run, my code is able to successfully detect and correct a single qubit error using the generators and the encode function that I copied from the papers I saw. Now that I've got this code written, I can test different versions of the encoding circuit or different generators creating new lookup tables and really experiment with how this 5-qubit error correcting code works and expand it to different codes that might be able to correct a higher distance or a greater number of errors. Q-sharp makes all of this easy by providing me with utilities for dealing with different data types, converting from arrays of results to integers to use in my lookup table, and utilities like measure that make it really easy to do joint measurement across arrays of polys and qubits. This gives me all the tools I need to explore different quantum error correcting codes. And that's just the beginning. You can use Q-sharp to write your own libraries or consume libraries that others have written, interact with Python inside of Jupyter notebooks, and eventually set up your code to execute on real quantum hardware via Azure Quantum. I hope you've enjoyed seeing how I use Q-sharp to explore error correcting codes. Happy quantum coding!